Okay, so I'm not the only person who encourages drugs in the workplace. My next guest has made a career out of studying psychedelics and marijuana, and somehow he's done it all legally. He's the founder and executive director of MAPS and my personal hero. Please welcome Rick Doblin. Hi, Rick. Okay, so what does MAPS stand for?
MAPS is a multidisciplinary association for psychedelic studies.
Okay.
I felt like I needed to have psychedelic in the name so people would know what we were about.
And you practice microdosing at work, right? Or what do you do?
Well, we mainly do research with people that are suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder or fear of dying, people that have life-threatening illnesses or addiction. So it's mostly not about what we do at work, but it's about helping people who are suffering.
Okay, I'm sorry. Of course it is. I don't know why I said that. But can you explain what microdosing is?
Yeah, microdosing. Before he died, Albert Hofmann, who invented LSD, lived to 102. And before he died, he told me that the most important area of research with LSD that hadn't been explored was microdosing. And so what that means is using low doses that you don't actually perceive that you're tripping, but you have a little bit of an opening, a creative opening.
Right, yes.
Yes, and it works terrifically.
But how did they not explore that? Because if he invented LSD, wouldn't he have started by taking small amounts? Isn't that microdosing?
Well, he actually did that, and he thought he was taking a very small amount, which was in 250 millionths of a gram. But it turned out that's a massive dose. So his first, that's why we call it, the first experiment is called Bicycle Day, because he had to leave work and go home on his bicycle. And it turned out he thought he was dying. They called the doctor, they gave him milk as an antidote, which did not work. And in the morning, he felt that he'd been rejuvenated. And so that was his first experience, was actually a large dose. And then people started using large doses in therapy to bring up things from the unconscious.
Because I've done a lot of acid. I did a lot of acid in high school. I took my SATs on acid. And it didn't go great, obviously. And that's why I never went to college. But I love the way that your mind, you know, obviously there are so many benefits. And you read all these articles, and now people are coming around a little bit with the idea of psychedelics and that all the kind of... So would you say it opens you up creatively? I mean, there's no studies to prove that, right?
Well, there have been research with mescaline and LSD in
What's
the 60s.
Mescaline exactly?
Mescaline is the active ingredient in peyote.
Okay.
The peyote cactus.
And have you ever done peyote?
Yeah.
Oh, what's that like?
Yeah, I feel it would be irresponsible for me not to have done these
drugs. Right. You seem like a very happy man. I would like to do drugs with you.
Yes, I would look forward to that.
Yes. You've done ayahuasca? Have you done ayahuasca?
Yes, I have.
And you do that a lot, right?
Not a lot. No. It's more of a deep spiritual kind
cleansing.
Of therapeutic cleansing. You're vomiting. And,
right.
You don't do it a lot.
Yeah, I don't like throwing up. So, I would prefer, acid's fun because you don't vomit, you know?
Right.
Mushrooms are fun because you don't vomit. Ayahuasca, it's like, I don't want to throw up again, you know?
Well, but you have to link your emotions to the purging, to the vomiting. So you're getting rid of psychological material. So it's not the most pleasant, but it can be beneficial. We've done a study with ayahuasca for the treatment of addiction and shown that it was pretty helpful.
Yeah, so that helps people. A lot of people, when they do ayahuasca, they quit drinking or they quit whatever, you know, addictive behavior. I've heard that too.
Yeah, and it can be used. These are tools. If you think of them as tools, and they can be used for creativity, they can be used for psychotherapy, they can be used for spirituality, they can be used for recreation, for celebration, and it's the context that determines if it's beneficial or harmful.
And do you think that LSD microdosing will be something that's legal at some point while we're still alive?
Yeah, I think so. I think assuming we survive the next 4 years.
Right. I'd like somebody to give Donald Trump some fucking acid. He doesn't even drink, and I don't trust people like that. You need to experience things to have an opinion and have a different viewpoint from where you come from.
Yeah, I think fundamentally, though, you have to choose to take something. We shouldn't dose people.
Sorry.
And
you shouldn't dose people.
We shouldn't dose people. If we could inspire him to do something, I would recommend he started with MDMA. Because...
Yeah. That's a great drug, too.
Well, there was an incredible article in the journal Cell, which is one of the most popular scientific journals, just in a couple weeks ago. And it was by two neuroscientists at Stanford. And it said that MDMA promotes empathy and compassion.
Yes.
And so that's where it would be helpful.
And they're talking about, what do they do? Call it phase three now, testing of MDMA?
Yeah, we just had a big meeting on Tuesday with the FDA.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. You're a big honcho. I like it. Make sure you give your information to my producer. And I'm serious.
Yes, let's do
it. We're going to party together.
Something together. So it was a big meeting. We've been working since 1986 when I started MAPS. So MAPS is basically a nonprofit pharmaceutical company trying to make MDMA, LSD, ayahuasca, marijuana into prescription medicines. And so we've been researching for the last 30 years about how MDMA helps in a variety of things. And so the meeting with FDA was about moving to phase three, which are the pivotal studies to prove safety and efficacy to make it into a prescription drug.
And so when would that happen? What year would that happen?
2021 is where we're
2021.
On schedule.
Okay, that's cool. 5 years?
Yeah, and actually we've been approached recently by some veterinarians who wanted to know if MDMA would be helpful for traumatized dogs. And we're actually talking about trying to start a study, and I think it could be helpful.
I would test it on Tammy before I would test it on Sean. Tammy's more of like a street dog. She's like, oh, it has a bat, like a pass. She's my other dog, and she's like a little hookery. You know what I mean? She's from the wrong side of the track. Chuck, he's been through enough, and he's, you know, he's just settling into his life now. So, but you can take the Tammy dog if you want her. I mean, she's just sitting pretty in Bel Air. So ecstasy, so that would be, is that microdosing, or is that not the right terminology?
No, microdosing is basically for a drug where you don't know that you're taking it. It doesn't produce visual distortions. You're not really tripping.
So ecstasy, the amount of that wouldn't be micro ecstasy.
No, it would be a full dose of MDMA.
Okay.
And it's in combination with therapy. So it's really the combination with therapy that makes it effective.
And MDMA you wouldn't take repeatedly, right? You would take that a couple or a few times. You wouldn't take that over a long period of time because that can really damage your brain, can it?
If you do it too frequently, all drugs have risks. And so we have a 3.5 month treatment process with more or less weekly non-drug therapy, and people take MDMA only 3 times.
Okay.
And it's with an 8-hour session with a male-female co-therapist team, and they spend the night in the treatment center. And we're working with veterans and people who've been victims of childhood sexual abuse and adult rape and assault accidents. And we show that people who've been stuck with PTSD, sometimes for decades, can heal.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah.
Okay, so you can read more about Rick's research at maps.org. And thank you so much for being here. It was such so nice to meet
you. Thank you.
Let's move on to food. Without it...